أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. سورة إسراء. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. سنة من قد أرسلنا قبلك من رسلنا أقم الصلاة لدلوك الشمس إلى غسق الليل وقرآن الفجر إن قرآن الفجر كان مشهودا ومن الليل فتهجد به نافلة لك عسى أن يبعثك ربك مقاما وقل ربي أدخلني مدخل صدق وأخرجني مخرج صدق واجعل لي من لدنك سلطانا نصيرا أقم الصلاة لدلوك الشمس إلى غسق الليل وقرآن الفجر إن قرآن الفجر كان مشهودا ومن الليل فتهجد به نافلة لك عسى أن يبعثك ربك مقاما وقل رب أدخلني مدخل صدق وأخرجني مخرج صدق وقل رب أدخلني مدخل صدق وأخرجني مخرج السلطان النصير. وقل جاء الحق وزهق الباطل. إن الباطل كان زهوقا. صدق الله العلي العظيم. اللهم صل وسلم وزد وبارك على رسول الله وآله الأطهار. صلى الله تعالى محمد وآل محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيد المرسلين. So I'm sorry that slide didn't work, but we can talk without it. So the topic we are going to talk about is that how Quran is unlike any other book and what are its implications on understanding the Holy Quran, translating it and understanding it properly. So when we think about a book, a lot of books come to our mind. We think about a book of history, we think of book of science, we think of book of fiction, novels, stories, we think of books of art, instruction manuals, all these kind of different books. But if we ask ourselves that, and human beings, you know, human beings cannot think of anything beyond what they have experienced. So leave Muslims aside, ask any people and mention about book, and immediately their mind will go to one of these books, and when they approach a book, they will expect it to be like that. That's what they will expect. And that's how people also approach Holy Quran. Because they have a set idea about a book, and then they approach Holy Quran and they don't find, because Holy Quran is not like a book. It's not a book of history. It's not a book of science. It's not an instruction manual. It's not a novel. It's not fiction. It's nothing. It's a book of guidance. So when they come to the Holy Quran on the premise this is a book, and they have a preset conceived notions about the book, then they have a difficulty. They get confused that what it is about. So not only that human beings cannot think of a book which is unlike the usual books which we know, but a human being cannot even write one. If we, any of us, try to write a book, we will still be writing in the known pattern, the way books are. So, what the Holy Quran is not a book, any of those kinds. It has history. And so sometimes people think that maybe it's a book of history, and that thought is actually strengthened by when they look at Old Testament and New Testament, and you know what? They are written in a style of a history book. You look at the Old Testament, it starts with the creation of the universe, and then it goes from Adam to generations after generations. So it's a biography. A collection of biographical books. If you look at New Testament, it's also a biography of Jesus. So people expect Holy Quran to be like that as well. So when they don't find it that way, they are confused. Then another kind of books people are accustomed to is books of science. And because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions science in the Holy Quran, and those signs are miraculously accurate according to all the discoveries science makes. So some people think, approach Quran as a book of science. And unfortunately, sometimes Muslims also try to portray Holy Quran as if it's a book of science. And when that kind of expectation is set, when non-Muslims approach or non-Muslim scientists approach Holy Quran, and they find it not like their scientific text, they get disappointed and they think, oh, it's just like another religious book. So we have to be very careful in explaining what Quran is all about. And Quran itself defines itself. ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِي هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. It's a book of guidance. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls it Huda. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls it Noor. What does Noor does? He shows you the way. What is Huda? Huda is guidance. It tells you how to go from where you are to your destination, how you achieve your goals. So it's a book of guidance. So it's not a book of history, it's not a book of science, it's not an instruction manual, it is a book of guidance. So from when we talk about guidance, usually we think that because guidance is taking you from your starting point to your destination, so then they will expect it that it will be step-by-step instructions. And Quran is not like that either. And that's why it's not like an instruction manual either. So there are that important differences there. So the Holy Quran, what does it guide about? It guides about, and its topic, its theme is guiding individuals and societies to establish fairness and justice individually and collectively as societies. You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us in Holy Quran in Surah Al-Hadid, لَقَدْ أَرْسَلْنَا رُسُلُنَا بِالْبَيِّنَاتِ وَأَنزَلْنَا مَعْهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْمِيزَانَ لِيُقُومَ النَّاسُ بِالْقِسْطِ. That we have sent our messengers with balance and with guidance and gave them the book to do what? لِيَقُومَ النَّاسُ بِالْقِسْطِ, so that people live with qist. And what is qist? Qist is justice, fairness, balance, equity, equilibrium, moderation. That's qist. So that's why messengers were sent. That's why Quran was revealed. And that's the topic of the Holy Quran, that how every human being who follows Holy Quran and the societies who follow the Holy Quran, they will have justice, fairness, and goodness in the society. So that's its topic. Now, so it's a book of divine guidance. So it uses and quotes historical anecdotes to make the points of guidance. And that's why it doesn't start with the creation of universe and the creation of Adam and then goes to next generation and then goes to next generation and then goes to next generation. It doesn't do that. And that's why, other than Yusuf alayhi salam, it does not describe the story of any messenger or prophet at one place. Because that's not the objective. Even the story of Yusuf alayhi salam was given at one point because people had asked as a test. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the whole story at one point so that people can see that, okay, this is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But other than that, it uses a lot of historical anecdotes, but they are all used for explaining the points of guidance which Quran wants to make. So that's why it doesn't tell the whole story. It uses only that part of the story which will highlight the point of guidance when Quran is making at that moment. So Musa alayhi salam is mentioned many times in Holy Quran, but every time it's from different aspect, making a different point of guidance. Or sometimes some points of guidance are repeated as well. So the history is used in Holy Quran to impart the points of guidance, to explain those points of guidance, to give people examples that we are telling you this, and if you look at this history, that you will find what we are telling you is valid and you should care about. So, and so a lot of times Muslims approach Holy Quran still, because it mentions those historical incidents, so they still want to get the full story. So Musa alayhi salam, Nuh alayhi salam, Isa alayhi salam, any other prophets and messengers, what happens is when they don't see the whole story, then they go searching for information in the books which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has already rejected, which are corrupted already, which we don't know whether they are reliable or not. And a lot of times, very big scholars take information from there which is unreliable. In my tafsir, the Holy Quran, I've written, I've given a lot of examples from the story of Yusuf alayhi salam, and Musa alayhi salam, and Nuh alayhi salam, where I have demonstrated that how totally unreliable fake information was taken from those other books without much scrutiny and made it like a lot of the books of which are written about the lives of the prophets, they take that information. Think about this. If that information which is missing was important, Allah would have included it. That information which has not been included was not important for our guidance. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provided only that information which was important for our guidance. So we should not, first of all, two points I'm making here. First of all, we should not approach any of those things from trying to understand history. A second thing is, wherever we find gaps, we should not go and borrow the information from other sources, because those are not reliable. We know what is in Holy Quran is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's truth. And if there was more truth needed for our guidance, Allah would have provided. So why do we go anywhere else? Why can't we just be happy with what Allah has provided to us? Now, if we look from the scientific point of view, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions it's not a book to teach science. That's not its job. Its job, because human beings can explore science on their own. These are physical things. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides us from the things which are beyond human capacity. But to attract the attention of the people, to guide people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions signs. And the beauty of the signs is, and there are two miraculous points in there. The signs are mentioned in a language that a Bedouin living in a desert, having no knowledge, can relate to those signs as much as a research scientist of 21st century. They are described, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has miraculously used those words that everybody, from totally ignorant person to very advanced knowledge person, each person, everybody in the spectrum can relate to those signs on the level of their own capacity and still get the guidance which Allah wants to impart. That's the miracle of the Holy Quran, that the signs are described in a way that everybody can benefit from them for the point of view for which they have been referred to. And the second thing is, another miraculous point in that respect is, that the more human beings understand, the more they research, the more they discover, the more truth of those signs becomes evident. And that's why we see so many things which science discovers now, and we say, oh, mashallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had already mentioned that. So this is an important point, that we should not approach, we should not even talk to other people, tell non-Muslims that Quran is a book of science, because it's not. It's a book of guidance. But it uses scientific facts as signs to guide people. So when you mention about La uqsimu bi mawaqi'in nujum, innahu laqasamu Allah ta'ala, I'm just giving you one example. I have actually written the whole book of all those signs and how those signs never get outdated. The signs mentioned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Holy Quran, they will never become old, they never become outdated, they never can be falsified, because miraculously Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned them in such a manner that the more we learn, the more we understand those signs. So Mawaqi' al-Nujum, what is Mawaqi' al-Nujum? Mawaqi' al-Nujum is where the stars fall. So people can understand according to their own understanding, but astrophysicists will immediately understand, oh, this is the black hole. When a star approaches and comes to the event horizon, it cannot go back and it falls there. So what I'm just giving you one example. There are very many examples we can talk about. But I'm just showing you that Quran is not a book of science. Its job is not to teach us science, but it has mentioned signs so that persons of every age can get benefit and see that this Holy Quran is not a human product. It's from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it has mentioned the signs and manner eternally, that regardless of the level of our knowledge, we can understand them and we can relate to them and we can get the guidance which they impart. And that takes us to another point, important point. And that important point is that we need to differentiate between, when we are approaching Holy Quran to understand, we need to differentiate between signs and commands and instructions. So when commands and instructions are given in Holy Quran, that's it. We cannot put our opinion on them. The way they have been described, and the way Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam practiced them and demonstrated to them, that's it, that's their meaning, fixed forever. We cannot change, we cannot put our opinion, we cannot say, okay, maybe we can do it this way, or maybe we can do it that way. No. The way they have been described in Holy Quran and the way Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam put them into action, that's it, that's frozen. But signs, as I mentioned, they are for the guidance of, that's from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to us. So we have to take it as given. But the signs are for us to reflect upon so we can get the guidance. So we cannot apply the same rule there. When we don't understand this difference, you know what happens? Those people who want to see that all the signs with the knowledge we gain and the research is done, so there are new explanations come in front of us. So they want to apply the same thing to everything in Holy Quran. On the other hand, those people who are rigid and they are frozen in a time and they use as if it's the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the signs are also command of Allah, they don't want to accept anything which is new. And that creates a problem, that creates a confusion. So we need to understand the difference between the signs which Allah has mentioned, which we can understand according to our own knowledge and understanding, and the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where we cannot use our own judgment or speculation or our estimation or our opinion or anything. It has to be exactly as described and practiced by Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and demonstrated by him. Okay. So from that perspective, what I'm trying to show is the Quran has, yes, it has history. Yes, it has science. Yes, it has instructions. But it's none of them. It's a book of guidance. Now, let's talk about how it is. I've shown you some way that it's unlike other books. But let's focus on how it's unique. How did Quran come to be? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to guide people. He sent a messenger. And the messenger was commanded to start a mission with the first command, Iqra bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq. The mission was started. And that mission was given to the Prophet, the same mission which was given to other messengers I have mentioned earlier, to establish the system of Islamic justice and fairness throughout in the human societies, making individuals adapt fairness and justice, and making societies adopt fairness and justice. So Prophet ﷺ started the mission, and he continued with the mission until the mission was completed, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself told, إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتْحُ وَرَأَيْتَ النَّاسَ يَدْخُلُونَ فِي دِينِ اللَّهِ أَفْوَاجًا فَسَبِّحْ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّكَ وَاسْتَغْفِرْهُ إِنَّهُ كَانَ تَوَّابًا. From start to end, every step of the way, Prophet ﷺ was guided. He was told exactly what's the next step. People are objecting, how do you respond to them? People are asking questions, what is response to those questions? Your followers, what they should be doing now? Next step, what they should be doing? And all that Sharia was completed and law was given and practices were given. So all those instructions which were given to the Prophet ﷺ at different times over 23 years period, that's Holy Quran. So now, so the mission was fully guided mission. The messenger is precisely guided every step of the way by Allah's own words on a timely basis as needed. So the Quran is the revealed messages, and it contained instructions for the Prophet, invitation to the disbelievers with logic, natural science, and historical anecdotes, responses to the opponents, their objections and their questions, and guidance for the followers. All of those in Allah's word which came were collected, and it became the Holy Quran. So I have again big definition of what are the contexts of the Holy Quran, but I think I have made the point. So, but you'll notice another difference here as well. It is not narrative of the prophetic mission. It doesn't describe how Prophet started, when did he do next, when did he do next, and how he reached his destination, how he achieved the goal which was given to him, how he completed the mission which was given to him. It doesn't describe that. It's not a narrative of that. So it's not a biographical style. So only because if you want to describe that manner, then a lot of other information would have to be provided. That okay, Prophet did this, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed this verse, and kuffar said this, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed this response. It's not like that. Only what came from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that's preserved. There is no commentary with it. The beauty is that once a revelation came, it was never edited. You know, think about it. I have written the Tafsir of the Quran. It took me 14 years. And ask me that how many times I have to edit it and change it and fit and find the proper words and everything. Here, the words came from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this, that's final, done. Never, they were never revised, never anything was deleted, never anything was added, nothing was ever changed. Whatever came was permanent, eternal. It's the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And not only that, its style was superb from any standard which was used in Arabia at that time. People were stunned with its beauty. And there was Labid was a very famous shair, and he became Muslim. And after that, he stopped saying poetry. And somebody asked, why? Is this Abad al-Quran? And I'm going to say some poetry after Holy Quran? Because the standard has been set, and nobody can meet that standard. But again, think about it, and especially this is the point which we should explain to our young people and non-Muslims, that without editing, it came to be a superb prose. And the point which makes very much difference in our understanding is The one very particular aspect of the Holy Quran is that it uses the minimum words for maximum meanings. Minimum words. You will never find, you will never be able to remove any if or but even from there. And that's why when we have to translate it, when we have to understand it, a lot of things which are given, not mentioned in the Holy Quran in the words, but they are implied either by context or by the structure of the sentence. So when people don't keep these two things in mind, then a lot of things are left unsaid because they are, for any discriminating reader, they are evident from that structure of the sentence and from the context where the sentence is placed. So if those two things are not considered and you translate only the words of the Holy Quran or you try to understand in those, then you will be misguided because you have left a lot of things which are implied there. So that's also very important from the style of the Holy Quran perspective. So another thing, it was compiled not in the order of revelation. It didn't happen that, okay, the first revelation will be first, and then the second, and then the third, and then the etc., etc., and the final. No, it's not that way. Actually, the compilation of Holy Quran is by a command of Allah. And it didn't happen after the Quran was finished. It was happening instantly when revelation was coming. With every revelation, Prophet ﷺ was told that this verse or these verses will come after this, before this. This surah will come after this, before this. Immediately, exact point where it will fit was given. So the day last revelation came, the compilation of the Holy Quran was complete. It's just like jigsaw puzzle. You know, children make jigsaw puzzle. You take piece, put here, put there, put there. When you put the last piece there, the picture is complete. In the same manner, the revelation came in pieces, but immediately, with every revelation, Prophet was exactly told where it goes. And with the final, last revelation, the compilation of Holy Quran was complete. So now you can imagine that the words which came and were never edited still became a superb prose, such a meaningful, revolutionary, miraculous book. And while it was, if you see from non-Muslim perspective, random sentence sent here, there, and suddenly they become such a marvelous book. People usually ask why it was not compiled the way it was revealed, why there was a different order of compilation. Compiling, I'll give you an example. You know, mashallah, you have a huge center. And when it was built, how was it built? First of all, there was excavation done, right? Then the basement walls were poured. Then first floor was built. So there was a certain order of building the thing. Now, in using the building, is that order relevant? No. In utilizing the building, that order is not relevant. This Holy Quran was revealed to be guidance, eternal guidance. So not only it guided Prophet ﷺ and the Sahaba and all people at that time, step by step, but it has to serve as a guidance for the Muslims until the Day of Judgment. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave in the order when it was being built, in the building order, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala compiled it with His own command, the way it will be most useful for us who will come afterwards. If somebody said that, okay, it could have been compiled in the revelation order, But in that situation, you know, when revelation was coming, with minimum words, as I mentioned, message was being given because everybody knew. I was giving Dars of Quran last week about Aman Yatasaalun. Just think about it. That Prophet ﷺ started giving the message to people about hereafter. They believed in Allah, but they didn't believe in hereafter. So Allah, Prophet ﷺ, through Holy Quran, telling them about Akhirah, slowly, bit by bit, building on the concept of hereafter. And now there is a lot of questions happening, objections, criticism, ridicule. All those things are happening. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَمَّا يَتَسَالُونَ أَنِ النَّبَعِ الْعَظِيمِ الَّذِي هُمْ فِيهَ مُخْتَلِفُونَ كَلَّا سَيَعْلَمُونَ ثُمَّ كَلَّا سَيَعْلَمُونَ People know exactly what was being talked, what was being discussed, what was happening. There was no tafsir needed. People know exactly. So at that time, whether it was disbelievers or believers, whether it was Prophet or his followers, everybody knew exactly when the revelation came, they knew exactly what things it was referring to, what was the perspective, what was the background. We don't have that. If somebody would have documented that, and people have tried to document everything, and you can see in documenting how huge that thing is, and how controversial that somebody says one, another person says this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved us from all that by putting in a different order, and Allah says, okay, I'm going to give it a different order, and where the context where I'm putting the verses and the context where I'm putting the surahs is going to help you understand my message. And I'm making this point because context is very important. Nowadays, there is a big trend. People take a verse of Holy Quran out of context and they try to make whatever it means. Whatever they want to make it mean that way. No. Whatever meaning you take from the verse of Holy Quran, it must fit in the context where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with his own command has put that verse. And the surahs are the same way. I'll give you an example. You know, there is a difference opinion about Iqra bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq, whether it was the first revelation or not. Because some people think Surah Fatiha was first revelation. Some people report that Ya Ayyuhal Muddathir was first revelation. If you look at the context, you'll know that yes, Iqra was the first revelation. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Teen mentions about the messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by mentioning Ture Sinin and Baladil Amin and those kind of things. And then immediately after says, Iqra bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq, that Prophet ﷺ is one of those messengers to whom this revelation has been sent. And immediately after, we say, Inna anzalnahu fi laylatil qadr, wa ma adraka ma laylatul qadr, laylatul qadr khayru min alfi shahr. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with his placement has indicated that Iqra was the first revelation which happened in the Laylatul Qadr. So I'm just giving you quickly few examples. I don't want to take too much of your time, but there are many, many examples like that, that the context is so important in determining the meaning of the verses and the meaning and the seeing the how surahs have been put together. So we should understand the importance of the context because it was given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So now you can see the miracle of the Holy Quran. Not only the miracle, which the scientific miracles I mentioned, but even in this manner that random sentences being revealed, compiled, and as soon as the revelation is finished, this is a wonderful book. Now, in matters of compilation, I want to make another point. The compilation was not only in surahs, because basic unit is ayah and then surah. And the surahs, people have divided into 30 parts, so to make them easy to recite Holy Quran in 30 days. But that's human classification. divine classification from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is only verse and surah. And then these surahs are given in seven groups. For example, Surah Fatiha to Al-Ma'idah is one group. Surah Al-An'am to Surah Tawbah is another group. In that manner, there are seven groups. For each group, first one, at least one surah is from Mecca, revealed during Mecca, and or at least one surah is revealed in Medina. So Meccan and Medina surahs make one group. Surah Fatiha, revealed in Mecca. All other Al-Baqarah, Al-Imran, Nisa, Ma'idah, revealed in Medina. Second group, An'am and Araf in Mecca, Anfal and Tawbah in Medina. Third group, Yunus and many surahs in Mecca. It ends with Surah An-Nur, revealed in Medina. So all these have hikmah. And when we are understanding Holy Quran, we need to keep that in mind, because I don't know how much time I have. I should go into more details about the groups, or I should stop. I can skip. Yeah. Okay. Still time?
Yeah.
Okay. So what I was saying is that, for example, if you see that in each group, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about, you know, there was a mission. I told you that mission started with Iqra and it is ended with the completion of the mission. So there was a process. Each group retains that process. In Surah Fatiha, we start with there. And in Surah Al-Ma'idah, what do we read? Al-Yawma akmaltu lakum dinakum wa atmamtu alaykum ni'mati wa raditu lakum al-Islam deena. Completion. What happens in second group? Surah An'am starts in Mecca, talks about gives logical reasons, common sense reasons to accept Tawheed. Surah Araf gives the historical examples. Surah Anfal talks about defense. Surah Tawbah talks about offensive strategy now. And then we say, so in each group, you will see a progression of the movement. And I can show you on, actually, if you go to my website, I have described all the seven groups and I've shown how it works. So, so there is a structure to Holy Quran, not only in this manner. There is a structure in the compilation. There is a structure in many other manners. There are multi-dimensional structure to Holy Quran. And people are discovering those structures with the progression of knowledge. I'll give you one example, quick example. There was a philosopher who was studying Christianity. He was becoming a priest, and he decided to read Holy Quran so that he can give an effective response to Muslims. But he ended up becoming a Muslim. One of the things which led him was that he was a philosopher. He wanted to see that if the words in the Holy Quran, the author of the Holy Quran, knows the difference between use of the word and the mention of the word. The example is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I created Adam. So that's a use of the word. But Adam has been mentioned in this sentence, so that's a mention of Adam. Or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I've been very sick. Even today I was sick, so yeah. So excuse me for my cough. So So what happens, the example I want to give you, Allah Subhanahu says, إِنَّ مَثَلَ عِيسَىٰ عِنْدَ لَيْكَ مَثَلِ آدَمْ خَلَقَوْ مِنْ تُرَابْ ثُمَّ قَالَ لَهُ كُنْ فَيَكُونَ. That example of Adam to Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala is like the Adam of Isa to Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala is like Adam. Allah created him from dust and had be and he was. So you here, Adam and Isa both have been used to give a message. But they have been mentioned as well. So this person said, okay, the author claims that Adam was like Moses. Oh, sorry, Isa. Is it true? So, from use point of view, I can see the point. But from mention point of view, is it true? So he went through the index of the Holy Quran and he counted and he found exactly Adam mentioned 25 times and Isa mentioned 25 times. And he said, oh my goodness, is it by chance? And he started exploring. And he was amazed that throughout the Holy Quran, the use of the word and the mention of the word has been very consistent. He also discovered, you know, in Surah Tawbah, Allah says that the count of year with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is 12 months. And you count the word month in whole Holy Quran, it's only 12 times. You know, Yom is used so many times. You'll find Yom in Holy Quran is exactly 365 times. I'm just giving you some examples. So what I'm saying, this is one kind of structure. The structure of compilations was one. This is another. And there is a third, there is a fourth, there is a certain pattern the way Quran uses its arguments. I'll give you one example from شَهْرُ رَمَضَانَ الَّذِي أُنزِلَ فِي الْقُرَانِ هُدَى لِلنَّاسِ وَبَيِّنَاتٍ مِنَ الْهُدَى وَالْفُرْقَانِ فَمَنْ شَهِدَ مِنْكُمُ الشَّرَفَ الْيَسُومِ وَمَنْ كَانَ مِنْكُمْ مَرِيدًا وَعَلَىٰ سَفَرٍ فَعِدَةُ مِنْ أَيَّامٍ أُخَرَ يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ بِكُمُ الْيُسْرَ وَلَا يُرِيدُ بِكُمُ الْعُسْرَ وَلِتُكْمِلُوا الْعِدَّةَ وَلِتُكَبِّرُوا اللَّهَ عَلَىٰ مَا هَدَاكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. Now you see, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions شَهْرُ رَمَضَانَ الَّذِي أُنزِلَ فِي الْقُرْآنِ, that Ramadan is the month when Holy Quran was revealed. Those people who find the month, they should fast. If they are traveling or sick, they should keep their, they can skip, but فَإِدَّةُ مِنْ أَيَّامٍ أُخَرَ, then they should later on make up. So now you can see, whatever came, the last thing was that people who are sick or traveling, they can miss the fast. The immediately first response was they should make up their fast later on. Well, it took me a little data. Now you say, fal yasum, people should fast. It goes in parallel with that they should complete their days. And because it was Huda wal Furqan, Allah said, لَتُكَبِّرُ اللَّهَ عَلَىٰ مَا حَدَاكُمْ. And then it was شَهْرُ رَمَضَانَ الَّذِي أُنزِلَ فِي الْقُرْآنِ, and he said, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. So you can see how there is a structure in the whole way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes things. And this is just one example. And there is the other day there was somebody else giving how there are some circular structures built in the Holy Quran. So I'm just giving you that look at that these revelations which are happening here and there ended up with a book, miraculous in every respect, that even it had amazing structures built into it. The point, final point I want to conclude is the reason I give you the differences between the other books and the Holy Quran, not only to indicate how wonderful miracle it is, but most importantly, that we should not treat it as a book of history, but a book of guidance which uses historical examples to make its guidance points. We should not use it as a book of science, but as a book of guidance which uses scientific facts to guide us. And we should not use it as instruction manual, rather it's a book of guidance where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has provided the guidance dispersed in different places, so we can, in proper context, so we can benefit from the guidance in that context. So that was my words. أَقُولُ قَوْلِي هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُ لِي وَلَكُمْ لِسَائِرِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. Yes.
Thank you. In the beginning, you made a strong statement about external context, that actually the Quran is in such a structure that you don't need to seek outer context or external context. But there are people that they look at the internal context and then they find so many contradictions. If they consider themselves self-sufficient to like whatever is there in between, defatain. But for them, always there has been some solutions to solve the contradictions that they found in the text of Quran by referring them out to external context. By external context, I mean the words of Prophet and then the words of and the compilation of the hadiths to explain and interpret Quran. So for that, I was not clear what is actually the point that you are making.
Thank you for bringing the point up. I didn't mean that. What I was saying is, people go to Old Testament and New Testament, which are corrupted books, and bring information over there to fill the gaps of the stories of the prophets. I was referring to that. You are right when I say that the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala must be interpreted according to the way Prophet practices them. I'm saying exactly that the hadith of the Prophet, the sunnah of the Prophet is extremely important. So I'm not saying that there is the external context not be used. And also, obviously everybody doesn't have the proficiency and they will read the tafsir and books written by other people. So I was not referring to that. My point at that time was only about going outside Islamic sources to corrupted books and bringing the information from there and embellishing the stories of the prophets and messengers, and that usually creates some problems. So that was my point.
Any other questions, please?
Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum to all of you. The continuing program of the Quran Inquisition has been very successful. And again, you've been blessed with outstanding speaker. Ustad, you need biographies on the website for the Quran Academy, and if you read it, he has got tremendous accomplishment to his name. And we have been very fortunate to him come and listen to us. Inshallah, the Academy and our center can invite him again for a continuation of this thing. Thank you for that outstanding lecture.
Thank
on
you.
On behalf of the Quran Academy and the Ali, the advancement for learning Islam, I would like to present this small token of appreciation from the organization.
Thank you. Thank you.
You can give the site when you go to, just the site, initially your site.
Yeah.
Site, yeah.
So my website is altafsir.ca, altafseer, altafsir.ca. So you can read just the translation, or if you click something, you will also have the tafsir there. So, and all the groups are indicated there, and there is an introductory material which will explain you the some of the things which I mentioned here. There are appendices. So, or you can also go to alquran.ca, alquran.ca. Both will take you the same website, altafsir.ca and alquran.ca. And you, anytime you have any questions, or it's a fresh website, if you find some error or typing mistake or something like that, let me know. If you have some comments, feedback, let me know. Much appreciated.
Thank you. Perhaps you can agree to share your slides with us if he emails you
sure.
The previous presentation.
Sure. I can do that.